Hello everyone and welcome to our 11th Cloud Tooltime webinar. Joining us today, we have Thomas Haber to discuss integrating the Theia Waveform and Event Viewer. Thomas holds a degree in engineering robotics from the University of Wuppertal and has more than 20 years of experience in semiconductor development. He is the founder of TOEM GmbH and is involved in the visualization and analysis of complex semiconductor and multi-core software systems. Previously, he held various positions at Toshiba, Infineon, and Intel. If you have any questions for Thomas as we move through the presentation, feel free to ask in the chat or using the Ask a Questions tab at the bottom. And without any further delay, Thomas, over to you.
Okay, thanks, Hayley, for the introduction. So the name of the company is TOEM, and GmbH is basically the same as limited British companies. Yeah, so in this talk, I would basically like to cover two things. First thing is the story of the migration of Impulse. So where did we start from? What was our initial target? Where were the problems? And what is now finally the achievement? And second part is about possibilities to reuse this experience. So how to integrate into other solutions, how to extend to special needs, and what about services we can offer here? In the agenda, I start with a question, what is Impulse for those who don't know? So I prepared some short video clips to keep this easy. When we then actually started last or the year before, I don't remember really now, started with VS Code and Theia, we were faced with a bunch of at least astonishing obstacles, and you might already face something similar. At this point, I would like to highlight them. The Become framework is an internal framework that was built in parallel to Impulse. And version 3 is basically our answer to these obstacles. This results then into a common architecture for Theia, VS Code, and also the Eclipse IDE. I will next highlight how we organize the code for Java and JavaScript, as on both sides there are a lot of similarities. So when I talk later on backend and frontend, with backend, I mean so the Java code that runs in the backend inside of an OSGI server, and frontend is always that is somewhere in the browser. If this is in the VS Code Theia application or directly in the browser when it runs when it's web based. Then I will give an overview on the Become UI components that we've implemented, and then it's about integrating and extending. And I will talk about Impulse apps. This is basically, these are basically templates to build own Impulse-based applications. And we'll close with an outlook and we'll show the Impulse playground. So what is Impulse? Impulse is an event and waveform viewer plus analysis workbench. For engineers, it's to understand and debug complex semiconductor and multi-core software system. It's a generic tool. You can make it applicable to many different use cases. So you have one tool for different purposes, but this involves also some configuration for sure. Users install standard Impulse either from a marketplace or they get a version deployed by an integrator. So I hope you see this video clips here. So the Impulse viewer has an axis here on the top. Sorry, I need to change this. This is somehow flickering. Hope that it's getting better now. Sorry, again, I need to go back. Sorry for this. So the Impulse viewer contains an axis. This may be time, frequency, or something else. A set of plots in rows organized in form of a tree. And the control behind here is called the plot tree. So this is a custom control. I come later to this, what this means. And then there are cursors and you can zoom, pan, search any position. And there are views like here, these tables, or the inspector where you can inspect single sample values. This is here from a semiconductor project, or you might have a software system with threads, tasks, processes. Here you have just a time axis and a stream of events from this real-time operating system, and this is then shown in different forms, like here with tasks and ISRs. And additionally, you have here synchronized tables where you can inspect the actual values or events. This is here from an analog simulation. What you see here is that it can has multiple axes using time and frequency. Or you have something that is about logging, where you have logs from different sources. You may analyze with scripts, and you can sort and filter inside of tables. To adapt to customer needs, Impulse uses a lot of scripting. So this is about calculate signals, extract analysis results, define reference data, to send data to external ports like a TCP port, or to react on messages from outside like a CAN bus message. The scripting is integrated into the IDE, and typically Impulse directly shows the made changes. And Impulse has lots of dialogues. These are here modal dialogues from Impulse 2. Impulse 3 has non-modal dialogues. You see the videos before, they were from Impulse 3 already. But I'll show you this because we had so many dialogues and we wanted to keep them and we did not want to throw them all away when we moved to HTML. So Impulse is designed to handle huge data. So all the signal data is packed into binary chunks, and if they are of no need, they are laid out to the disk. It can work with files or resources in general, and also with streams, so it supports online display. It's extensible, like Eclipse is in general. You can add readers, dialogues, interfaces, and so on. It's highly interactive and scriptable. Then there are extensions available for different areas, like semiconductor area, HDL, when it's about Verilog, SPICE, virtual prototyping, real-time operating system, and software traces in general. You might want to analyze logs, if this is text, XML, YAML, or anything else. It can work with CAN bus or hardware devices like CAN buses, OPC UA, and scopes. And we are using P2 to select and install these different features. We started with Impulse in 2013, and release one was in 2015. This was based on Eclipse 3. We got a request at this time already for web-based Impulse, so based on Che, and we did some first try with GWT, but we aborted this at this point of time. And when we then started with Impulse 2 in 2018, we had already in mind that we want to change to web-based IDE, and Impulse 2 came out in 2019 and was based on Eclipse 4, where we used fragment files for commands, menu, toolbars, parts, shortcuts, and so on, sorry. And Impulse 3 was now to cover web-based IDEs like Thea and VS Code for desktop, but also for the browser, for custom HTML5 application, but still for the Eclipse IDE. So we did not want to throw anything away or we copy and then forget it. We wanted to have some common code base for all these platforms. Of course, we are a small company and it's difficult to support so much different code. So target was really to have one application code. And then we started and found, there is no modal dialogues or no dialogues at all. There is no UI. What we have are web views where you can put in HTML controls. And when you look into the market, then it's not that easy to get suitable HTML controls for such kind of application. So, for instance, a table. So if you want a table with a slider and maybe a million samples, and this is not a lot in this area when it's about simulation, then it's difficult. You also don't have access or no easy access to the system context menu, and the toolbars and menus are insufficient from our point of view. For instance, toolbars don't have a state, so difficult. And then paint performance was a question at the beginning. Paint performance on SWT Linux is so far okay. On Windows, it was always slightly more difficult. When we then started with HTML, we found that paint performance on all platforms is at least better. So paint performance is really no reason not to go to HTML. This here is the architecture for Impulse 2. Typical architecture for an Eclipse application or the Eclipse plugins. So what we have here is a framework. It's called Become. Here the big core component and specific Eclipse one. And we have the Impulse application separated typically in core and UI. And then there are lots of different extensions like HDL, Canvas, OPC, and so on. And all the Eclipse IDE bundles that together build one application, and that's easy and working. Become 2 is and was or was a set of design pattern. We use this design pattern over all our application and inside of the extension to have things at consistent as much as possible. There's an abstract data and resource model. Abstract data is basically based on classes with fields and some annotations. And the resource model adapts these data models to different inputs. So if this is a file, or if this is an Eclipse resource, or a preference, or any other kind of setting, we use everywhere the same data model. Also for the signal data, at least the surrounding information, and can have everywhere the same UI component also. We have basic SWT index clip Eclipse abstraction, but this was not complete in Become 2. And we have toolkits for many different areas, like there are menus, dialogues, text, XML, and so on. When you look into a dialog or a part where the actual UI is created, then you find everywhere this kind of lines, where it's about a TLK, so the toolkit, at text, and or at button set, or at combo, or at whatever. And then you have a container and a controller. And the controller does the behavior of this text control. When you want to change the behavior, you give it either different parameters, or you derive this controller. And so we have a bunch of a set of many different controllers for different purposes now. Additionally, there is some layout data and some settings. And you see, this is already quite abstract from the UI point of view, but still has a lot of dependencies to SWT, like you see here, this SWT radio check, and there are many more locations where it was very much dependent. So Ecamm 3 was to remove all SWT Eclipse dependencies. And we did this by using an abstract part model for the editors, views, and dialogues. But we still use E4 fragment files for commands, for toolbars, for menus, shortcuts, parts. I would say it's currently under discussion if we keep it or we change it at some point of time. There's an abstract painter interface that replaces the GC from SWT. And with this, we have custom control, like this plot tree, what I showed you at the beginning, is one. So a control that is mainly painted is a custom control and uses this abstract painter interface. Additionally, there are abstract interfaces to IDE servers, like showing messages, warnings, errors, opening text editors, showing progress, many things more. And beside this abstract part, there need to be real HTML implementations, mainly for the UI component set of for HTML. So this are the modules of Ecamm 3. You see here on the left side that the pattern, their data and resources, the toolkits, and then you have here the Ecamm HTML parts for for UI and IDE. They are quite flat as they are using RPC to just communicate with the front end. Again, on the left side we have the back end, so the Java code that runs in the GRE, Java engine with OSGI support. And on the right side, the JavaScript code that somewhere runs in some kind of browser. And here's the custom UI and the JSON RPC implementations on Java side. That is, again, a wrapper. And then on the front end side, we have the final implementation. So the pattern and the toolkit are from the functionality, the same as on the left side. They are basically a subset from its functionality and in JavaScript. Then there's also the JSON RPC and the custom UI. Again, here the custom UI has the same functionality as the one for SWT, as we are using this custom control with this abstract painter interface. Unfortunately, we need it here in JavaScript. Beside this control, there are also a lot of surrounding classes. So for configuration, like access, how it looks like, plot configuration. So a lot of surrounding classes around this plot tree that build basically this custom control. And then there are the real UI implementations here. So like tree or text control. So this need to be implemented using HTML elements. Together, this build one JavaScript file with a size of 350 kilobytes. This is the architecture for Thea and VS Code. We have the framework, the core component, and the HTML and the Equinox core. Then we have the application, again, the core, the UI, and additionally a server now, and all the extensions. And they're running the Java runtime environment as an OSGI server. And on the other side, there's a front end, in this case, Thea. And what we have here special is this blue part here. This is the IDE client written in TypeScript that does a communication with the backend and does things like showing messages. I said it before, input dialogues, the simple ones, and showing progress, instantiation of views and panels, and so on. And then you have the web views, so the parts where you have the actual impulse viewer inside and the views, what I said, based on web views, so pure HTML. And inside of this web views, you find this impulse JS, this 350 kilobyte front end code. When I This is for custom HTML application, completely the same architecture. The only difference here is this blue part, where we need a different implementation of this IDE client. And also Eclipse IDE is not that different. For sure it looks first different, but the important parts, this is the extension and the application, remain completely the same. On the framework part, we have still the same core and a specific one for Eclipse. And for sure, then you have all the Eclipse IDE bundles that build then the application. This slide is about communication, and there are basically two levels. You have the communication on the application level, and this is again about showing messages, open text editors, instantiation of parts, resource data, input dialogues, and so on, from the backend to the front end. When then a part is instantiated, so on this side it's the web view, then there is a specific channel from the part in the backend and the front end. And here it's about creating UI and handling the UI. This is a statistic about the lines of code that we have used in front and backend. On the left side, you see the become core. This is a large bunch. Then you see the become HTML. This is very thin. Of course, it's basically just contains wrappers with some state variables that use JSON RPC to communicate with the front end. Then you have the application impulse in yellow and the extensions in orange. This is again a big part that can be completely reused. Also, this first part, become core, can be reused in all application variants. Then there's this custom UI. This is, in our case, this plot tree with basically the information how to paint various things. And the front end code in light blue. And when you look below this axis, it states it's Java. And this might be a little bit confusing because the front end side, this should be JavaScript. And both is true. So when you look at the impulse modules, you find that there are a lot of similarities on back and front end side. For instance, the patterns and the toolkits are basically a subset of the ones on the left side. The JSON RPC is quite the same with some different implementation. The custom UI is, from functional point of view, the same as the one in SWT, as it uses this custom control and this abstract painting interface. But we need it in JavaScript. And there are UI implementations. For sure, they are different. Here is where text control is made with HTML elements. So what we're doing, we copy. We copy code from the Java backend into this light blue area. This is very much true for the pattern. This is very much true for our custom control, the plot tree. So the paintings, all the surrounding classes that build the interface, and so on. And it's less true for the toolkits, where a lot of the code is the same, but partly the implementations are different. This is less true for the JSON RPC. Again, lots is the same, but how it's done at the bottom is slightly different. And it's not that much true, or not true, for HTML element related stuff and for the UI. But even here, when you need to implement such UI component like a tree or text control or combo box, you can take the code from the backend, copy it here, and then you already have the function, you have the same checks, you have the same, or lot of the same variables inside, so a lot of similarities. you can take them and input the code that you need for HTML. So this light blue area then contains the copied Java code, implemented Java code, and specific JavaScript code in cases Java makes no sense or not possible to do with Java, like an interpreter can be very easily, JavaScript interpreter in JavaScript can be very easily implemented but difficult in Java. So this light blue area is then transpiled into this 350 kilobyte JavaScript code. Big advantage here is that when we look at to this custom UI about how something is painted, about all the interface classes that are required, how axes are built, how paintings need to be done, the paint plans. So there are so many classes around. All these classes stay completely the same in the front end. Next, I would like to show all the UI components that we implemented. This is about the UI standards here. So we have for sure something like text labels. Again, it's flickering, I guess. We have combo controls, different kind of radio controls, like normal, color, and tool radios. We have checks and different kind of buttons. Then there are different kind of composite, like the panel that is building up here this dialog. Then there are groups, expandables, tab folders. There's a table with unlimited size. So unlimited, what I mean is, yeah, for this purpose, unlimited. There's additionally sort and filter. We can do column reorder and resizing. And we have cell editors. There's the standard tree. And then there are custom controls, like it is on the right side. So the difference is standard trees are built of standard HTML components, and custom controls have a canvas. And there are dialogs. So there are modal dialogs. Then there are nested dialogs. There's drag and drop. There are toolbars. And everything is seam integrated. This slide is about traditional way of extending and integrating. So extending means that you want to add additional functionality to Impulse. For this, there's a registration to add a reader or a chart. And the other thing is if you want to integrate, so you have your application and you want to use Impulse as a part of it, then it's about integrating. And this means that a large bunch of your code will interact with the Eclipse IDE directly and may interact with the Impulse core. For this, there are interfaces. What I said, there's, we use the standard Eclipse registry and still using it somehow. For parts that can be extended, like readers, charts, producers, ports, resources, dialogues, data structures, and many things more. And there are part listener where you can react on changes when you do something with impulse, like opening something, or there are also mouse listeners available in impulse too. And you can send commands to impulse parts to change the behavior. And you have access to the resources. So you can add configuration, you can read the current configuration set, and so on to modify the behavior of impulse, how it works inside of your system. Typical example is this chart extension here. So you have multiple charts, you need data cell structure to keep all the configuration data for the charts. You have different dialogues that are integrated into the standard dialogues, and you need instances to create such a chart from the user point of view. This means now that when we get now to our new architecture with the back end here on the left and the front end on the right, we're still fine with this extension code. It's working in the same area inside of the GRE, in the Java, in the OSGI server. And it's just interacting with the impulse core, and this is still working the same as it was before. Problem is with this other code where you have been integrated, that was basically related to the Eclipse IDE code. This needs to be for sure migrated somewhere. And here we see currently two solutions to do this. You could use Become as your framework. So this means you build your application on this framework. You have maybe an own server, and you use Impulse as one of your extensions. On the front-end side, you may have a different JavaScript code that may contain different set of custom controls. Basically, you can build your application that way. But you might already have a certain client-server application with different technologies, or you have an extension that does not use a back-end code at all. For instance, an editor that does, so Verilog editor that uses Impulse just as a tool to show the results of what is implemented there. And this, for this, we have an interface on the front-end side. You see it here, and extensions can directly access this interface. And this is basically a replication of the plugin interfaces. So again, you have a part listener where you can react on changes, and you can send commands, you can access the resources, and we're currently thinking about other interfaces for this. Impulse applications are a mean to simplify building custom applications for Impulse, and they shall result into VS Code, Thea, and or Eclipse IDE plugins with your own listings on the marketplace. Example could be a file viewer for a custom trace format, an interface to read display events from custom hardware, or to display an analysis of measurement data. For this, we are currently preparing templates on GitHub. And the question behind this is basically how to use the VS Code plugin mechanism for features that are inside of the OSGI server, so that are implemented as an OSGI bundle. And what we have in this template is the typical VS Code extension code, like package.json, other things. There might be some TypeScript specific extensions, and it has an impulse dependency. And important is in this green box here, there are Java implementations for certain extensions like reader, Charles, producer, and so on, in form of a Java OSGI bundle. Additionally, there are implementation in C and C++. We have also scripted solutions here. To build this, we first experimented with Eclipse Tycho, and now change a little bit to VS Code Java as it is more smooth to our understanding. So I can show this example here. So this is the code of an example extension. You see here the bundle code in Java, so the package JSON with the dependency to impulse. And then I get into one of the reader classes. So this is a reader for analog data. And I just change the signal name of one of the input signals. Then I press F5 to start the extension. And I see the result. And when I click O, I'm clicked somewhere. This is, nah, I think we have to do this again. Sorry. Again, the bundle code, the dependency to impulse. And again, I change the signal name here and press F5. What should make the extension go live? And what you see here is that the signal name has been changed. And this can be also debugged very easily. So when I go back here, so I have a breakpoint set, and I attach to the OSGI server, I start it. I go back to the extension. And what I do here is now I reload, and this triggers then the reader to work again. And I'm in the breakpoint to continue. And this also supports hot cause replacement and so on. So quite smooth and not too bad. Okay, this is then the last slide. Outlook is for us, we want to complete Impulse in Q4 if possible. We also want to open become to third party. We're looking for partners here and we are thinking about an open source strategy. And we would also like to offer development services. If you did not were in touch with Impulse, then we made a playground where you can play with it. And I showed here in this last video. So if you go to this page, you find this Gitpod button. You can add your credentials, and then it takes some seconds before Gitpod is up and running. So here it is already. So you get into this repository and select one of the, this is an analog file. Impulse pops up and you can add a view, for instance, or you play around with it, investigate or inspect the samples in the table or inside of the inspector. You can work with the dialogues, so play around with this. Yeah, thank you. That's from this presentation. I hope you have questions. Thank you for listening.
Thank you for that excellent presentation today, Thomas. So this is just a reminder to anyone in the audience, if you have any final questions, feel free to put them in the Ask Your Questions tab or in the chat, and I'll give you a moment to do that while I wrap up. So the next Cloud Tool Time webinar happens November 23rd with Jonas Helming, as he joins us to present strategies for migrating Eclipse-based applications to the web. And you can register for that session using the link I just put in the chat. And then we also have our annual EclipseCon 2021 coming up October 25th through 28th. So be sure to register for that. as well as our Cloud Native for Eclipse Foundation Day, which is a full day of expert talks, demos, and thought-provoking sessions focused on enterprise applications implemented using Eclipse Foundation projects on Kubernetes. So both of those links I will also put in the chat, so you can register with those. Now, we're also looking to book more Cloud Tooltime webinars for the remainder of 2021 and for next year. So if you're interested in presenting a talk, just like Thomas did, feel free to sign up here. And then I think we have one question here from Matthew. So Matthew asks, I saw that Toam uses the CTF reader as the original author. Thanks. Do you have any success stories on that front? Maybe we can collaborate on this.
Yeah, this would be great. CTF, we started the extension in Impulse 2, but we did not get finally, it was working, but we did not get to the point where we can do this LTNG stuff that good. So in the meanwhile, we were working also on other similar tools like real-time operating system, where it's about that you have a data stream with one input, and then you fold this up to all these tasks and processes and so on. And so we built a base here. And definitely, we want to continue with CTF and make also this LTNG possible. Standard CTF was already working. And yeah, we were looking into different direction, especially when it was about very huge files, then for sure reading is sometimes possible. And Trace Compass did this also quite good. The approach in Impulse is slightly different. Definitely I want to come back to the CTF and LTNG as soon as possible when we are through this phase that we made Impulse stable again. And yes, I'm quite keen to contact you and get to more working solution than it was in Impulse 2.
Great, thank you. And then we have one more question from Christian. Could you share some links with us, example, your Gitpod use tutorial, if available, and similar?
Could you share some links with us, e.g. Gitpod use tutorials? Yeah, I can cite the, currently we have everything on GitHub. So GitHub/TOEM. You find the current state. So there you have the standard Eclipse, and you have Eclipse, the VS Code Impulse. Not Eclipse, Impulse, and also Impulse for VS Code is available. And there's a playground also, and we will also place here all the templates for the Impulse applications.
Okay, great. I see Erica just shared both those links, so they're there for you, Christian. And we still have a bit of time, so I can ask you one more question. So how do you see the importance of the Eclipse IDE compared to the Eclipse Thea?
For sure. Eclipse IDE had a lot of problems over the last years, and there are certain parts where there was real anger about it. And now many people go away, or if they start with something, they don't start with Eclipse IDE, but more with web-based IDE like VS Code and Eclipse Thea now. And at this point of time, probably both is important, but for sure Eclipse Thea gets more important over the time. So at least what I see currently.
Okay, great. And another question is, what do I need to use these Impulse apps?
Yeah, what you just need is this GitHub repository, and the target. So it's not there at this point of time, so I can notify you when it's available. So it's quite close, I would say. But what you just do at this point, you get to this repository, and you can again click on Gitpod, and then it sets up, and you can then add some Java code to maybe read a different form of data. Press F5, and then it's up, like I show in the presentation. And that's all what you need for beginning with it, and to create your own VS Code extension with it.
Okay, great. Thank you. And it doesn't look like we have any other questions. Erica said, is there an email list we can sign up for to get notified when it's available?
No, not from my side. And I also don't have your email addresses. And I guess, Haley, don't give it to me. I'm not sure. I don't know. And Haley, I don't know how this works, how people in this talk can get notified on certain things.
Yeah, so if you would like, I can share your email, Thomas, if you would like, and then they can contact you.
But yeah, they're open. Yeah, sure.
Okay, perfect. I will put that in the chat now so you guys have that. Just give me 1 second. Okay, perfect. So if you guys have any questions, I'll just put contact. You can contact Thomas via this email. And then he can just give you updates when it is available. And it doesn't look like so the extension yes. will be your okay once available. Okay.
So this everything will be available on GitHub. Also, all the templates for this Impulse app. So we are not ready. What I said, when you look at the version number of Impulse, then it states 2.4, 2.5 at the moment. So we want to complete. Or at least get close to one in this year. And not everything is ready now. So it's still a way to do.
Okay, great. Thank you. And it doesn't look like we have any other questions, but if you guys have any feedback on this Cloud Tooltime webinar, you can follow the survey just linked at the bottom, the green button there. I don't see any other questions, so I'd just like to thank Thomas again for this excellent presentation, and thank you to everyone who attended, and I hope you all enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you. Thank you.